Good evening, everyone. Tonight's topic, we are going to speak, Bezrat Hashem, about emptiness. In Hebrew, it's called rekanut. Rek means empty. Rekanut means emptiness. What exactly it means, rekanut, emptiness? It's perhaps the main reason why most of the people today in the world are depressed, not happy, upset, have anxiety attacks, all kinds of other attacks, frustration, lack of satisfaction, confusion, don't know what to do next, don't know what's going to be next hour, next day, what's going to be next month, always worry, always broken. You can go in the life of a person today, most people in the world, sometimes 10 years, not even one moment of happiness. Where does it come from? Obviously, the manufacturer of the world, God, the creator of the world, is very interested that every person will be happy, will see the light. That's the purpose of the creation, as the Ramchal say. Even though in Mesilat Yesharim, in Path to the Just, in the introduction and in the first chapter, the Ramchal explains that the purpose of this world is preparation for the afterlife, which over there is going to be the ultimate happiness. And finally, we're going to receive the reward of all the efforts that we invested in this physical world. But a person can be happy in this world. But most of the people that we see are not happy. Perhaps nowhere in history people use more drugs than they use in this generation. And also many of the Jews who made repentance, became religious in the last 15, 20 years, many of them continue to use drugs. They don't let it go. They continue to smoke, they continue to take all kinds of drugs. They may come to shul, they keep Shabbat, even dress modest. Many of them continue, without it they still depressed. So obviously something in the system is not working right. The computer has a bug, a virus. It may function partially, but it's not functioning right. So in order for us to cure the problem, there's a rule. What's the rule? The rule is that if a person recognizes the sickness, what's the source of the sickness, then maybe he can cure the problem. Not guarantee, but at least there is a chance. If a person doesn't recognize the sickness, what chance does he have to cure it? Nothing whatsoever. Can go 20, 30 years, the problem is still there and sometimes get worse. And that's why we see so much tragedies and mental breakdowns and people commit suicide. Even healthy people, not only people who are going to die with pain and suffering commit suicide. People that are very wealthy, nice looking, have nice cars, nice houses, big companies, all of a sudden they kill themselves. Musicians, famous people, unbelievable things. The answer to all this is the topic that we have tonight. It's emptiness. The more empty the person is from spirituality, from closeness to God, the more miserable he is. And it doesn't matter how much wealth he has and how much fame and how much people bow down to him and how many people run and fight to get his autograph. Doesn't matter. None of these things fulfill the soul of a person. It can fulfill his ego. It can make him an illusion of feeling great. But since it's a lie, once it's expired, the bitterness is much greater. Let me explain what I mean. When a person is in depression and he drinks alcohol, the time that he drinks the alcohol, he gets confidence, he smiles, he laughs, you know, he does a lot of stupid things. Once the alcohol wears off, his depression is much greater when he remembers his problem. So the alcohol solved the problem? No, the alcohol is like cutting the red light in your car, check engine, you cut the wire. Didn't fix the engine. That's what he did. He just shut the light for a few, 2 or 3 hours, and the light went back on. It's like we're doing reset. You go to the mechanic, and he doesn't want to fix your car. So he said, okay, let me do a reset. If it comes back, you come back again. Why? That's another way of saying, listen, I don't have time for you. I know we made an appointment. Come back next week. You know the lights were gone. So what does he do? He takes the battery off. He closes it in. So the car drives okay. No check engine. 2-3 days, it comes back. But it didn't solve the problem. That's alcohol. That's drugs. That's running away from reality. You don't need necessarily alcohol and drugs to run away from reality. Movies, it's another drug to take you out of reality. Wow, beautiful movie, nice, romance, life is great. Then the movie is over, comes out of the theater, it's back to his reality. You understand? Many people want to run away from reality. What do? They sleep all day. They don't get up. 11, 12, 13, 14. I mean, 2 o'clock. They don't get up from bed. They don't want to do anything. And remember, this is not only people who don't have a penny and people who are homeless or things like this. We are talking people who consider very successful. So the answer is, the Torah already gave us the instruction how not to get to this situation. And the Torah says like this. First of all, a person has to be busy. If a person is bored, life becomes a burden. It's a burden. When people are bored, they do stupid things. If they're busy, they're not doing stupid things. And that's before we're going into religion. Kids, take teenagers. The summer vacation comes, 2 or 3 months they're off. If they're all day on the streets, they're in a house, bored, they begin to do a lot of stupid things. You get them to work from morning to night, they're busy working, making a little money. They don't have time to do stupid things. Not that they don't want, they want. But the work keeps them busy. So that's already one indication that a person always has to be busy with something. If a person is busy, he might as well be busy with something that is the most productive one. What is it? Being closer to Hashem. Now, the problem is that it's not easy. That's the problem. It's not something you buy once and it's in your pocket and that's it. As long as you keep it there, it's there. It's something that comes and goes all the time. You get closer and then 2 steps back, 1 step forward, 2 steps back, 4 steps forward, 1 step back. It's like on and off. It's like you're getting pushed off constantly all your life. It's not something that you have and that's it. In this world, it's very difficult to be close to Hashem every minute of your life, all your life. There's always ups and downs. In the afterlife, everyone is rated. You're rated in a certain level. And that's how you enjoy the sweetness of God, the greatness of God. This is what the Gemara say, Yoshvim tzadikim v'ne'enim miziv ha-shechina. The righteous people in heaven, they sit with a crown to their head and they enjoy the greatness of God. But not everyone enjoys the same greatness. The greatness is the most ultimate that you can think of. But not everyone gets it in the same level. There's many, many different levels. Lefum tzara agra. According to the sorrow and to the efforts that you put here in this world, how much you invested, you show God that you really care. That's how much he's going to reward you for the life of eternity. Hayom la'asotam u'machar lekabel scharam. Today to do, and tomorrow to receive the reward. One of the main things who cause emptiness in the life of a person, when he's not learning Torah, and he's not connected to Hashem, he's looking for happiness. And it's very difficult to find happiness. So there is one trick that the Satan always draw to a person and always fool him. What is it? It's a very common problem. Almost every person in the world fall into this trap. 99.999% of the people in the world, Jews and non-Jews, are falling into this trap. Everyone in the end see that this illusion brought them nothing, no emptiness, no nothing, no happiness and no nothing. And they still continue again and again to fall into this trap until the moment they die. What is it? Running after money, materialism, etc. That's it. Once a person runs after money, materialism, more and more and more and more, the more he gets, it causes him some relaxation for a day, for 2 days. Wow, finally I got a nice car. 2-3 weeks, it's over. That spell, that trick, it's over. And then you're back to square one. And then you walk, you kill yourself, and you get a nice house. So you have 2-3 months of happiness, supposedly. It's not really happiness. It's on an illusion, because people that think that it's happiness, that means they never tasted the real happiness yet. And then once they get used to that, they go back to square one. Eventually, a person can have $200-300 million and he still have full empty life, full of sadness. Like I always like to ask, what's better to be? Miserable poor or miserable rich? You heard that, no? You should know it by heart by now. And everyone think, well, miserable rich. At least I don't have problems with the bills, mortgage, this, stress. Truth is, miserable poor, it's better. Why? Just for the illusion that he thinks that one day when I make the money, I'll get out of my misery, that keeps him going. And he's not so depressed because he has hopes. The one who's already reached the top of the pyramid and he has a lot of money and he's still miserable, what else he has to expect for? Unless if he discovered the Torah. Unless he discovered the Torah. Once a person discovered the Torah, all his hunger for money and materialism begin to drop. But there are many things that cause us to be like this. First of all, it's where we live. We are jealous. We're jealous of what we see. Jealousy is a very bad habit. You're jealous with what people have. You go to relatives of yours, they have nice houses, they have nice furniture, they have nice jewelry, they have a nice car, they have a nice this and nice that and food and all kinds of things. And you begin to jealous and you're forgetting that it's very foolish to be jealous. What is it like? Let me explain to you what it's like. It's two people who go on a road test because they both want to be drivers. They want to get a permit. So one has a nice Toyota with air condition and leather seat and sunroof and great stereo system for the 5 minutes road test. And the other one has an old Ford who makes noise, drives not so smooth, air condition hardly works, no sunroof, and the chairs are not leather. And the one who sits in 5 minutes here and 5 minutes there, they both have 5 minutes and is very jealous that the other one got a nice car with leather seats and air conditioned. That's the most stupid things you ever heard. What do you care about this, you fool? You're going now to be 70 years a driver. You're going to have your own nice car. You worry about this 2-3-5 minutes road test? Not one normal person would care about this. If you take a normal person, say, do you mind if you drive in this car for 5 minutes or this car? So, 5 minutes, who cares? But every one of us is like that. Put all our energy in this jealousy and looking for physical satisfaction and missing the main target. And we heard it 5,000 times. And did we change? We're still the same. We still have dreams. We're going to buy, we're going to make another million, and then vacation, and then I can relax. It's all like a circle, constantly, and we never get anywhere. We basically never get there. You know, the Tanakh that Hashem gave us, the Torah, the Tanakh has 24 books. We never appreciated the Tanakh well enough. Did you know that the Tanakh is the best seller in history? But by far, what's the best seller today in the world? The best seller in history is the Tanakh. It was printed until today more than 3 billion copies. Until today, since printing was invented, It was already printed, the Tanakh, by more than 3 billion copies. How many languages it was translated to? When it came out, the first generation, it was translated to 70 languages. That was 3,300 years ago. Since then, there were many, many mini nations. One nation came from the other, and they invented their own language. Languages change all the time. So there are much more languages. How many languages the Tanakh was printed in? Who knows? More than 2,000 different languages. Did you know there are so many languages in the world? Huh? Yeah. More than 2,000 different languages. World record. World record. Now, if we really appreciate how lucky we are, that we really have the ownership on the Tanakh. Everyone can use it, but who really have the gift that Hashem gave this to the world? The Jews. And what did they do with that? They never used it. They used it, if they filled themselves with knowledge of the Torah and the Tanakh, they wouldn't have emptiness. The Rambam says, and everyone in Chazal would agree, that the more empty a person is, the more nonsense he's doing, more nonsense he's busy with. If a person is full of wisdom, there's no time for him to do stupid things. He's full of wisdom. Once he's empty, he begins to deal with lots of nonsense. That's why today you look, sometimes you see women that have no intelligence, no education, no knowledge, and you look at them how they are, you want to cry. Every day, new plastic surgery, this, now in needles here, make it this, that, all kinds. She has the smallest nose in the world. No, it's not good enough. It has to be like this, putting this. Okay. After a while, it looks like a plastic person. Doesn't look like a human being anymore. It's all from emptiness. Where does it come all this from? Emptiness. Also, buying a house, $20 million house. Every person in the world would die to have a house like this. Better than a palace. Tear the whole house apart, bring an interior designer. I just saw it a few weeks ago in my own eyes. And remodel the whole house for another $1 million. If this is not empty, and then complain nonstop how miserable she is because the job is not getting done, and maybe she picked up the wrong colors and the wrong couches, and maybe, you know, the husband is angry and all kinds of things. This is all emptiness. Someone who's full of Torah and closeness to Hashem, he cares about this nonsense. It's no problem of wanting a big house because it's productive. You can bring guests, people can sleep by you. One day somebody from your family doesn't have a place to live, he can stay by you for a few weeks. A big house, you can do a lot of good things with that. Storage room, you can store for people, you can do chesed. There's a lot of things you can do. But to go crazy about these things, to drive you crazy, all your life is into these things. What is it like? A person said to his friend, listen, I need you to drive my car from New York to L.A. And I'll pay you for that. When you get to L.A., you get $5,000. So what's the purpose? Getting the car from New York to L.A. That's the purpose. And what's the reward? $5,000. What happens if a person that starts to drive the car after 1 mile, stop, clean it, wash it, change the mirror, change the wheels, doesn't like this, all like this. 6 months is busy with the car. Drive 1 mile, changing it, go to the garage, move this, do this. The person who sent them on a mission goes crazy. What are you, normal? I told you get the car from here to there. That's the purpose. Don't put all your life into this car. You know, some of the goyim who buy cars, some Jews copy from them. From the minute they buy the car, they're busy with the car more than they ever be busy with their wives. All day they stand next to it, brush it, spray it, all kinds on the tires, they put oil. You put oil on the tires. Wow, that they will look fancy, would look flashy. Sometimes they have real garbage cars, it's all falling apart, but they make it cosmetic, you know? Emptiness. Also, by the kind of music a person listens, you know how intelligent he is or not, believe it or not. Music shows a lot about the intelligence of a person. Is the way he dress. You bring me any person, the way he dress, Jew and Goy, I tell you right away, more or less his IQ. The dress shows a lot about your inside. You know, like the kids with their pants down and the way they walk, shows who they are. It's no coincidence that they like this. They never learn a word in their life in school. They're always connected to the worst culture in exist around us. They became like them. It's no difference. Even though they have a divine Jewish soul, but it's so filthy with mud that the divine disappeared completely already. Nothing divine left there. It's so much, you know, you take your best diamond and you stuff it with mud. Where is the diamond? You need a lot of cleaning until you see some shine comes out. So, this is the words of the Chazon Ish. Listen good. I read it once or twice in the past, but it's worth to read it 5,000 times until we get it in our head. I'll read it in Hebrew and then I'll translate. It says, Im adam ubaal nefesh. If a person has a soul, ushat osh at hasheket, and he reach a moment of silence, free, chofshi, free, mira'avon ta'avani, free from physical desire, physical hunger, then az ro'et ha'olam be'einayim be'irot. That's one of the most brilliant sentences I ever heard, me, myself. Then he see the world with free eyes. Finally, you come out of the cord that covers you and you see the truth. Which means, when a person is deep in materialism, he can't see the truth. Materialism is bribe. The Torah say that even the biggest rabbi in the world, someone like Moshe Rabbeinu, if he will get bribed, he won't be able to see the truth. Not that he's going to think, okay, this person paid me $1 million under the table, I'm the judge, I must rule for his favor. Otherwise, I'm going to lose $1 million, no? That's not true. That's not what the Torah said. The Torah say, Shochad ye'aver enei chachamim v'yisalef divrei tzadikim. Shochar would make the righteous chachamim, the scholars, blind. It didn't say it would make them lie. When you lie, you know you're lying. It say it will make them blind. That means when they say the lie, they're 100% convinced it's the truth. Why? Because they cannot see the truth once they got $1 million. Once you got it, you cannot see it. If it's your son, you cannot see the truth. If it's your wife, you cannot see the truth. If it's your father is going to court, you cannot see what everyone see. You can see. You want to see, but you can't see. If you are so deep in your hunger for luxury, for art, for cars, for all kinds of trips, you cannot see the truth of life. It's not that you see it, it's over there the truth, but I'm not interested. You cannot see. That's why when you speak to these people that are so deep into materialism, into their television shows, into their comedies, into their sport, into everything that they do, you show them the truth, every fool right away would see. It's like black and white. There's no way to make mistake. They cannot see. And you wonder, this person is really dumb? It's not dumb, he's just blind. He can be the smartest person in the world. You close his eyes, he cannot see the truth, that's it. This bribe, it's already make us completely blind and we cannot see the right path. Same thing when a person has a girlfriend and he lives with her. And you try to convince him that it's the biggest sin and he cannot do it and he has to separate at least until they get married again. You know, he cannot see. Why? He's receiving bribe every day. The bribe of material pleasure makes the person blind. And right away, he's convinced that the rabbi exaggerate, it's not so bad. Why the fanatic like this? It cannot be that Hashem is so strict. Yeah, you show him in the Torah. He reads it. He understands Hebrew, no? He understands. It's simple Hebrew. You know, everyone understands what karet means. Ve'elisha benidat umata lo tikrav legalot ervata. But yet, he has 5,000 excuses why it's permitted in his case. Why he cannot see the truth? bribe is a very serious danger to our life. So the Chazonis say the only way to see the life in clear, free eyes is after you first of all got rid of all your desires and you have a peace of mind, you're not busy with nonsense. Two conditions. First, leave your physical hunger on hold for a minute. Put it on hold. One day. I don't care about it. Whatever happened with that happened. My account, my stocks, businesses, the register, how much I made in that store. Put it aside for a minute. Whatever happened, happened. Let the money go who knows where. Just get rid of it for one day. And the second thing is, don't be busy with anything else. No emails, no music, no sport, no news. Put it away. Take all the electronic away from you a day or two. Clean your system. And then open a page and read and you see the feeling of what does it mean to be happy. As long as you're busy, it's one of the most brilliant way of the Satan to destroy us is to keep us busy with nonsense. With nonsense. Everything that is bad for us, he keeps us busy with. This and that, non-stop, non-stop all day. Then, the Torah say, there is a pasuk, Kidvar Hashem Baza. He, despite the word of God, Dvar Hashem Baza. Baza means disrespect. Even worse than that. Sometimes you disrespect a person, he says something, you don't answer him. But you didn't really curse him or insulted him. You just ignored him. It's an insult. But it's much worse when you come and attack in front of 1,000 people, no? Over here, it's the worst level of insult. Dvar Hashem Baza, Bizayon. Bizayon. Disgrace. Who is he? Who knows? What's the meaning of this verse? Are we in this category or no? Anyone here can raise his hand and say he thinks that he's in this category, that every day he disgraces the name of Hashem and insult God. Who can say that he's in this category? Is anyone here who wants to be in this category? I'm sure not. Not Jews, not Goyim. Nobody wants to be in this category. But all of us are in this category. Some more, some less. Why? Who knows what's the meaning of the verse, Kidvar Hashem Baza? Who knows? The translation is like this. Ze she'efshar lo la'asok ba'Torah ve'eno osek. Someone who has the ability to learn Torah and he doesn't. How can it be? I just describe what does it mean to insult. You gave me a nice letter that you wrote to me and I didn't read it. So is that means that I insulted you, that I cursed you, that I ruined your reputation in public, that I step on your head in the street? What does it mean? The answer is sometimes worse. Why? Because if the creator of the world gave us a letter and he asked us clearly, I want you to be busy with that every day. It's a long letter, but there's plenty of time to learn it. And we don't touch it, but we receive all the benefits from him. What can be a bigger insult than this? You take away everything I give you, and the whole purpose I created you was for this, and you take away all the tools and everything I gave you to be busy with what I ask you, you take away everything from me and you don't touch your mission. That's a big insult. That's cause emptiness. That cause you to be empty and to be depressed and to be upset and to be sad and to be moody. Moody. People who are full of Torah, you never find them moody. 1 hour angry, 1 hour happy, 1 hour dancing, 1 hour crying. 1 hour you call them, yeah, how are you? Wow, great to hear from you. 2 hours later, oh, what do you want? I'm busy, don't bother me. You don't find them being moody. Talmidei Chachamim, you don't find them moody. They're always busy with the Torah. Nothing in the life bothers them. When you're not busy with the Torah, you have time to think about nonsense. And it's redesign your life in the wrong direction. Then there's another say the Chazon Ish say. Listen good, I translate it again. Im yizkeh adam le'argish, If a person will have the merit to feel et ara, the bad, ve'animas, you know, like when you get sick from something, be'eder yediyat ha-Torah, of being ignorant, if a person will have the merit to realize how horrible, how bad is the ignorance of not knowing Torah, עד שימס לבבו בבכי, until his heart will melt from crying. The heart, do you understand the expression, what we're saying here? A person will cry so much that he has no heart left. His heart is dead already, finished, from crying. It happens to one person in the Talmud, who knows? Who did it happen to? That he cry until he died from crying. Who? You ever heard about a person who cried so bad that he died from crying?
The guy who made all the sins with ladies?
Yes. Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya. He cried so much from his sins when he realized he was going from one prostitute to another. And in the end, one Goya prostitute told him, "You're such a lost case. Even God doesn't want to look at you." The Goya told him. And he realized, and he went and cried and cried and cried until he died. If the Chazonis say, if we get to a point that we cry so much that the heart will melt when we finally understand how horrible it is to be an ignorant Jew, Ine yeda, and that will be a sign to know, Ki kvar zacha be'arbe. You should know that you just elevated yourself to a very high level. What very high level? I don't know one word of Torah. Just the fact that you realize how miserable you are of not being attached to Hashem and knowing His Torah, you got to that level, you're already 60-70% up in the top of the mountain. Don't know one word yet. How do we get here? You understand how deep it goes? It's very important to know, not to be ignorant, to know Torah, to be connected to Hashem, to know what to do, what not to do, of course. But if you don't recognize how miserable you are not being connected to Hashem, being what we call in Israel, datiloni. You know what datiloni means? Most religious people in the world, datilonim. You know what it means, datiloni? 1 hour dati, 1 hour chiloni. 2 hours dati, 4 hours chiloni. Depend on the mood. And depend on his way. He leaves work. On the way to work, he goes to shul. So 1 hour is dati. If he really daven. Some people come to shul to play with the text messages. But let's say he davens. So 1 hour is dati. He comes out of the shul. He goes to the restaurant. He eats a bagel, kosher. He makes birkat hamazon. So he's still religious. So 2 hours into the day, he's religious. Then he goes to Manhattan. Soon as he gets into Manhattan, he becomes Vinny and Otoni. Vinny Otoni. Every girl on the street, like this, his car bumping into this, but goes like this, the signs, Broadway. So 8-9 hours, he walks in Manhattan, complete goy. Then Mincha. He comes to the shul, 20 minutes religious. Then Arvi, 20 more minutes religious. Then he come home, begin to scream at his wife. The food is not good, not cold. Why, you know, I don't have a great meal. Not religious. Behave like an animal. Then he goes to sleep. He says Shema, 5 minutes, religious. All together, 2.5 hours is religious in a day. That's called the Tiloni. How many hours he learned Torah? Nothing. Sometimes on the way to Manhattan, he listened to a good CD. So another half an hour, another 40 minutes is religious. You add together, take away the sleep, take away the bathroom, that he cannot be religious in the bathroom. Cannot learn Torah, cannot do mitzvot. So take the bathroom, take the sleep, take the doctor visits, take all kinds of things that takes away the person's life. Now take all the hours that he was busy like a goy. How many hours in his life he was a Jew? How many hours? All together, 5% of his life, 10% of his life. And for that, he wants to get to the highest level of the afterlife. He wants to sit between Moshe Rabbeinu and the Rambam. You know? Why? I walk with a yarmulke. Muhammad also go with a yarmulke. Yeah. Ma, you saw in the airport, 4 o'clock in the morning, I was there in the terminal. I saw one Muhammad put his mat, 500 goyim walks on his right, on his left, in the middle of the terminal. Doesn't go like us to the side, looking for a corner. In the middle, right away, like this, 4 o'clock in the morning. You understand what's going on here? So the point is, we sometimes think that we are something, but then we will have a bitter disappointment that we're really not what we thought. And the question is, maybe we can wake up now before we be surprised. That's the question. Chaval, it's a shame to lose both worlds. Why I say to lose both worlds? I tell you why. Because sometimes a person becomes Baal Tshuva. He makes repentance. He changes things in his life. He begins to keep Shabbat. He begins to eat kosher. He's not going away to the clubs anymore like he used to go. He switched his friends to different friends. He's trying here, trying there. But he messed up in certain things. And in the end, he doesn't enjoy this life because he missed his whole life, all the sin he used to do. And then, God forbid, he doesn't have a share to the world to come. So he gets stuck. In Hebrew, we say, kereach mishne hatzdadim. It stays bald from both sides. One person that is bald in one side, the other side, he can grow hair and cover it. You know how they do? One side, they take it like this. One person is bald on both sides, has no way to take. That's why they have this expression, nishar kereach mishne hatzdadim. Bald from both sides, that means you try to get this, you try to get that, you try to get both worlds, you're left with nothing in the end. Then, Chazon Ish finished. After you find out and your heart is melting with tears, that you realize how bad it is to be an ignorant person, Muftach lo shetfilato nishmat. Now you know that you are already in a level that everything you ask from Hashem is going to listen to you. Positive, of course. Right? Then, a few more things. One is, you know, in the afterlife, who knows what is the main punishment?
Murder.
What's the main punishment of a person when the moment he dies?
Shame.
The real punishment right away, what is it? Shame, embarrassment. And definitely, that's a spiritual punishment. That's the hardest punishment. What's the proof? What do you think it's a worse punishment? Physical pain or spiritual pain? Spiritual pain means a shame, embarrassment. That you get shame in front of everyone, you're embarrassed. They show you on the screen, on television, the whole world see what you did. Candy camera, you didn't know there's a camera. That's definitely much better, much worse than getting patches or who knows what. Because the patches, you have the pain, but the pain in the heart, in the soul, is much, much stronger. What's the proof? I always like to give this example. In a boxing match, right? One boxer, the green boxer, hit the red boxer so bad that the red boxer collapsed. And now the ref is counting. 10, 9, 4, 3. So what does he do? The loser, he hold to the rope and he climb, he try to stand on his hand, on his legs. And what's the first thing he's worried about? To wave to the crowd, like this. In 1 hour he heard in the hospital that he's dead, concussion in his head, there, his brain split open. First thing he cares about is to stand and to go like this. And everyone clap, I'm still standing. He's willing to take all the physical pain, that not 1 minute of embarrassment that everyone go, ooh, he went down, what a loser. Look at the kids, no matter what, the embarrassment kills them the most. They can't deal with the embarrassment. You embarrass them in front of their friends. Ask your kid if he's embarrassed from you that you come to school. You know the mothers that run to school to bring their kids the sandwich that he forgot to take or a coat? So it makes the kids very embarrassing. I never understood why. But the kids, no matter how nice and fancy his mother is, should be the president of the United States, he's still embarrassed that she came to school. So if you ask him, tell me, what do you prefer? That I bring the sandwich tomorrow to school, or I give you 5 good punches to your head? What would he say? Give me the punches, don't come. Why? The embarrassment. But the Torah already said that the shame is a bigger punishment than physical. Who knows where? Which halacha proves it? Which halacha proves it? You know, there's a halacha that said some of the sins that a person does, they hit him with a whip in a beit din, in a court. One person is holding a whip and he hits him. How many times? 39. Not one more. 39. 39 shots. What happened to some of the people? Once they get the patches, it's painful. Sometimes when a person has physical pain, he loses control and he makes in his pants. Excuse my language. It happens to people from the fear. Once it happens, the Torah says you cannot give him another patch. He got his punishment already. Leave him alone. He got a much worse punishment, the shame, the embarrassment. No patches can ever replace. That's why many people who got caught or put them on the news, next day you heard they killed themselves, they shot themselves in the head. You give them kicks to the stomach, you break their head open, they won't commit suicide. You put an ad on them on the newspaper, many of them will kill themselves or hide 6 months. They go to a different country 6 months and nobody would see them. Until slowly, slowly, they'll relax from the shame. And where are we going to run when we die? That's the question. Shame begins. Over there, there's nowhere to run. That's what a person has to remember. Sooner or later, I'm going to be there. I can run away. I can fool everyone. I can do things like I do right now. But over here, I can still somehow manage floating above the water. What's over there? What are you going to say to Hashem? Wait, I'm running to Europe. Where are you going to run? So, we have a very common problem today in our society. What is it? The science dictates the value of society. The development of science is developing the values of our society. And that's a very big mistake. It should have been the other way around. The value should be already declared and clear, and they should overcome any development or any kind of change in the world. Cannot be that every device will develop or everything that changed supposedly and was discovered all of a sudden changing the value of human being. Cannot be. That's not what Hashem says in the Torah. Hashem says, I'm giving you certain things to benefit you, to help you, to save you time, but that's not coming on my expense. Hashem gave us computers to benefit us or to ruin our life. To benefit us. You know how many things you can do with that? Positive emails, this, that, save you so much time. Internet, to benefit us or to ruin our life? To benefit us. What do we do with everything he gave us? Destroying ourselves. And we make rules, that will make our sins easier, that we don't live with a conflict. For instance, birth controls. That's an example. Hashem sent AIDS to the world to wake up all the sinners that there's a serious price to pay already here to the sins, not only in the afterlife, over here already. Why? To help us prevent ourselves from falling into this desire. So what did we do? Found a way around it. But nobody thought, wait a minute. It's like the story with King Solomon. One person came to him and said, I want to know the language of the animals. He said, no, it's not for you. You don't need. Teach me every day. He said, okay, let me teach you. So he taught him. So the next day, you hear the roosters are talking. It said, today, robbers would break into our master's home. and will steal something from his bedroom. Right away, he put bars on the window. Everything got safe. So, King Solomon, the smartest person ever lived. I told him I want to know the language. He told me, no, it's better for you not to know. The next day, here the roosters are talking. What happened? Today, our master's son will break his leg on the street. He told his son, you don't leave the house today. No school, no nothing. Don't go out of there. Here, take ice cream, stay here. Nothing broke. That's what King Solomon told me, it's not good. The third day he heard the rooster saying, today the angel of death come to take the soul of our master. What is he going to do now, put bars? So he ran to King Solomon, told him the story, 3 days in a row. Told him, see, I told you, you fool. He didn't say fool, I added. He said, see, I told you. First day, Hashem only wanted to warn you by losing $100. The robber comes in, you lose $100, you wake up, you make tshuva. You don't need to break legs, you don't need to die. Your life gets saved. You thought you smart, you went around it. So now the warning is stronger. You thought you smart, there's no more warning. Two warnings, you lost the opportunity, you're dead now. There's nothing you can do. You cannot go around it. The Torah say, Hashem say to us, et mispar yamecha amale. The number of your days I will fulfill. I will make them full. Who knows what's the meaning of this verse? It's one of the blessings in the Torah. I am going to make the number of your days full. There's few explanations to it. Let's go one by one. The simple understanding is, you're supposed to die 80 years old, you won't die younger. You live full life. I will fill up your days. Second explanation, every individual day has 24 hours. How much of it we really taking advantage on? 5, 6, 7, that's it. Most of it goes on garbage. Watching soccer, watching basketball, sitting in a park, sleeping, snoring, eating. You know, most of the time is gone. Net, from that, how much you eat? It's like a fruit. We take the fruit, after cutting the peel, taking all the garbage, the pits, everything, there's almost nothing left. You know this fruit? After cutting everything, a little bit left. So the day is really no blessing. How much you gain? Two Mishnahs you finish today. One page of Gemara finished, all day. But if your days are full with blessing, it can be 4, 5 pages, 4 times more. And in general, in life, you can do a lot more. So then you need a blessing. How you get blessing in your days? Hashem helps you not to waste time on nonsense. People won't bother you. Visitors would not come accidentally to surprise you and take away your time. You don't have long lines. You don't get stuck on traffic. You don't have to spend 2 days a week in a mechanic because you bought a lemon car. Your wife doesn't drive you crazy every 5 minutes. I forgot diapers. I forgot potatoes. Oh, I need 2 garlics. Can you go over there? Can you go to that store? They have it maybe. That have. Then tomorrow is a dentist. The next day is a doctor's appointment. When you don't have blessing in your life, you achieve nothing. You live, you live, you live. But in the end, what did I do? Nothing. All week. What did I do? This is the blessing. Et mispar yamecha amale. But amale with what? That's the third explanation. I will fulfill your days with blessing. What kind of blessing? Sport? Olympic Games? One guy from 80 broke the world record by running. For 3 hours, he cannot sleep from excitement. You care about him now. Oh, 2, 5 Americans, one against the other, fighting who's going to score the basket. And he cannot sleep for 3 days from the excitement. You understand what emptiness caused the life of a person? And the sad is that when people that are empty listening to me, they'll think I'm crazy. This guy's crazy. What is he talking about? How can you live without sport? How life would be without these NBA finals? How life is going to be without the Europe championship? Somebody asked, sent me an email. Did you watch the game between England and somebody? So I say to myself, I better make tshuva right away if he thinks I have time for this. That's already a bad sign. You understand what's happening here? David HaMelech says, Shivtecha u'mishantecha ema enachamuni. Who knows what does it mean, Shivtecha u'mishantecha? מה זה שבטך? The stick. The whip, the stick. חוסך שבטו, שונא בנו. If you don't hit him sometimes, that means you hate him. If you give him a patch here and there, that shows you love your son. Doesn't apply anymore. Because the more you give them, the more they're going to go off the way. But in a normal generation, that's the way it should be. That the kid get one patch here, it's enough for him to understand for 5 years now. Not to be chutzpah, you know, not to have chutzpah. But the idea is that what does it mean, Shivtecha u'mishantecha ema enachamuni? David HaMelech said to Hashem, your patches, מה זה משענתך? משען, it means what you lean back on. Like in a chair, you lean back. So you patch, and you support me, not to collapse. You give a patch, you hold me, not to fall. Hema enachamuni will be my comfort. Did you ever hear someone who likes to get patched? Who wants to get patched? But he said, this is my greatness, this is my pleasure, this is my comfort. Your patches that you give me, even though, you know, I'm not collapsing, you're supporting me, this is my comfort in life. Who knows what's behind it? What does it mean? Huh?
That means he didn't give up on him.
No. Good, good. That was good. What did you say over there? Also right. Both answers are, this is the two answers. Very good. First, that I know no patch is extra than what I deserve. It's all supervised and precise 100%. Second, better to get patched here than over there. You get $1,000 you lost. You cry. Do you know how much suffering it saved you from the afterlife? So what are you crying for? If they tell you now one day in jail, or pay 1 month of your salary not to go to jail for 1 day, you see all the monsters over there, how they look. Just you look at them, you die. So if they tell you go to jail for 1 day or pay for 1 month of work, what normal person would say, put me in jail? Only if it's really, we have mental sickness that is very stingy, is willing to die for a dollar, it's a different story. But normal person will not go. Hey, okay, let me walk the whole month, and believe me, he will sing all month for giving his money away. Because he know what he got in return. Freedom from 1 day in prison. Freedom. So David HaMelech says, since I know hakol be'ashgacha, everything is supervised, I know nothing is coincidence, that's my comfort. That I know you're with me, you're supporting, you're helping, you're punishing, that's very good. It's a pride, an honor to be punished by God. You get punished by the police, it's an insult. By the secular court, it's an insult. By one of your enemies, fine, but to be punished by God? That means he cares about you. Otherwise, he would leave you alone like a dog. If he gives you a smack, that means you disturbed him. If you disturb him, that means he has feelings towards you. If a father has 10 sons and one of them is completely a big criminal, drug addict, who knows what, he brought him so much agony to his life that he doesn't want to look at him anymore. Whatever he does, he doesn't care anymore. He gets to a point that he's already erased him from his life. Doesn't want to look at him. But the other ones, every little thing they do, he yells, he talks to them, he gives them punishment. What do you see? So the one that his father doesn't give him any attention, he does more negative things that maybe he also will get a patch. And when he gets the patch, he feels great. Finally, my father cares about me. That's called negative attention. We all like this. We do it to the boss. We do it to the neighbor. We do it to, you know, in relationship. It's called negative attention. You don't get positive, you might as well get some kind of attention. That's what happened to us. So what's the solution, really? Today, there's a good thing today. Women, they're all day in the house. They have children, babies, the husband at work. Women that don't go to work. What's the best solution for them? They have radio stations. All day, Divrei Torah. One lecture after the other. A little music in between. 45 minutes, 50 minutes. All day, Divrei Torah. Cutting onions, Divrei Torah. Cutting potatoes, Divrei Torah. Cleaning the house, Divrei Torah. But what does women do? Put the radio on mute and talk 3 hours nonsense and Lashon Hara on the phone. Replacing diamonds with poison. So you gotta clean it from their life. Yeah, but I have to have social life. Social life, yes. But poison, no. Also, stay away from people that have bad influence on you. People who care only about nonsense, about vacations, about flashy, fancy food, these trips, restaurant, cars, nightclub, this singer, that singer. What are they going to give you in their life, these people? You enjoy an hour or two supposedly with them, and then the bill would be served. You know how thick the bill is going to be? Hundreds of pages to pay it now. Nothing is for free. Nothing. Everything stolen has a price. What's stolen, you have to pay double than the original price. Mayim gnuvim im taku. For the sweetness of the stolen, there is a double price. You give a person a bottle of water, $1, and one to steal. And he stole one. He put it in his pocket and got away. Which one he enjoy more? The one he paid for or the extra one he stole? The extra one he stole. He feel great. Ah, that came for free. No, my friend, that's cost you $2. You just didn't get the bill yet. The credit card will be served. The bill will come. Only a fool, when he shops with his credit card, thinking, I won't have to deal with the payment and the interest and the penalty. But we all like this. We accumulate sins, and we forget that the bill is on the way. That's what Rabbi Akiva say in the Mishnah. This world is like a supermarket. Like Chenvani, they didn't have supermarkets in his day. It was a tiny store. When I was a kid, there was no supermarkets. But there was also, at least in Israel, I don't know here. But like 35 years ago in Israel, you had tiny groceries. 9 feet by 7 feet. That was the size of the store. A few shelves with bread, some little refrigerator, tiny, some olives, cheese, and milk. A few donuts on the counter. A little bit candies here and there, very little candy. Not 1% of the candies they have today, they had in my days. You know, for us, if we had a bag of Bamba and a Beastly, it was a major party. Once a week, I had a bag of Beastly. I come to every closet, you open 500 different kinds. Cookies falling on your head from all over. You go to the supermarket, you spend a day over there. 5 items you want to buy, your day of your life is gone. 600,000 mitzvot are gone to buy 5 items in a supermarket. Why? We shop with our eyes. Wow. Yeah. That's how it was. So Rabbi Akiva say, HaOlam Hazeh, it's like a grocery store. There's the owner of the stores that lets you take whatever you want, and he writes in his notebook. And everyone comes and take whatever they want. That's the people. And the owner of the store is Hashem, but one day he sends his collector. It's written. One day the price will be sold. Rabbi Akiva, 2,000 years ago. The greatest Jew ever lived. Reached the highest level, even higher than Moshe Rabbeinu. And started his life at age 40. His spiritual life. His Aleph Bet he learned when he was 40 years old. So before we conclude, and maybe I give you some time for questions, the conclusion of all this topic that we spoke about today is that you have to remember, nothing will fill your mind and your soul good like the Torah will. Nothing. If you think there is replacement for the Torah by learning this, by learning that, by learning history, by learning math, by reading novels, by romance, all kinds of life stories, entertainments, whatever, none of it will fill your life. It's all a drug, temporary drug. 1 hour, you are excited and it's over. and another hour and it's over. Not like the Torah. The Torah makes you close to Hashem. Being close to Hashem, the effect of it is tremendous. Right away, there's no place for depression. You never find in a history a person that is very close to Hashem that is depressed. Whether he has a wife, whether he doesn't have. Whether he has money, whether he doesn't have. Whether he has nice shoes, whether he doesn't. He has a car or he doesn't have a car. You don't believe me? You make an appointment with me and I take you to see my first Rebbe. The one who taught me Gemara in the beginning. Rabbi Rafael Rosenman. You look for him in Monsi. You come, ask, where is Rabbi Rosenman? You see him coming out of the yeshiva and walk in the street. Like this, in the moon. He's in the moon. And he doesn't know what pills are or drugs. I promise you. No alcohol, none of this. He doesn't know. All day is in heaven. From the effect of the Torah on his life. Why? Because this is not only a learner. There's many learners that are busy in two different worlds and the bad world destroyed the good world in them. It's like mixing water and burn oil together in the same bucket. The oil ruins the water. If you have only pure water for 50 years like this, from morning to night, non-stop, then you really feel the presence of Hashem. The presence of Hashem. I know it sounds strange. You ask yourself, what can make me happy by reading Gemara and understand what's the what Rashi say and what Tosfot and how it falls into place in the Gemara from a different and everything fall into the place? Okay, it's very interesting. But how is it going to make me happy? The answer is, you're not going to get a logical answer to it. Because your logic is, I learn history, I know history, I learn math, I know math. Doesn't make me a happy person. Any kind of knowledge never made me a happy person. If I'm depressed, I'll be depressed. Whether I know math, whether I don't know math. Whether I know the news, whether I don't know the news. I'll be depressed. If I'm not depressed, it doesn't matter. Torah is not the same knowledge. That's what people don't get. That's like a mystical thing. It's like a magic, like a spell of God on you. Because you're bringing God into your body. That's what the Zohar say, Israel and the Torah and HaKadosh Baruch Hu one, they are one. They are one. It's a unity of Hashem, the Torah and the Jews, it's one. One, it's one integral thing, you cannot separate them. If you learn Torah, Hashem is in you. You don't learn Torah, Hashem is not in you. You put tefillin, very nice. You eat kosher, very nice. You keep Shabbat, very nice, but Hashem is not in you. Why? Because you have filth in your mind, filth. Filth, bad movies, bad music, all the YouTube, seeing all these rappers, all this cursing. How do you want Hashem to be in you? It disgusts us from you, disgusted. And especially if you know you're 7, 8 years old, Shomer Shabbat, the disappointment from you is even greater than someone who doesn't know what he lives for. 7 or 8 years, you know the truth and you still listen to this garbage? This is the most important thing in your life. This is what you put in your ears. This is what you go to sleep with after you say Shema. You disgrace my name. You learning Torah, you come, and an hour later you buy yourself drugs and you smoke. No, it relaxes me. That means my Torah is not good enough for you, huh? So you have to check yourself. What's rotten about you? Where is the sickness? That's not going to cure the problem. Like Chinese acupuncture. They can only make the nerve system eliminated for a day or two. They don't cure the problem. They just take the nerve, they pinch over there, so the nerve, you know, gets some kind of influence. And 2 weeks later, all the pain comes back. Find me one person that they really take away the problem. It doesn't. It's just an illusion. Okay, it's a relief. It's like painkiller. Person has a big headache. He takes painkiller, he doesn't feel the headache for 4 hours. Better than nothing, no? But did it cure the problem? No. There's only one problem. Taking a painkiller, it's not a sin. Listening to garbage music is a sin. Watching dirty pictures is a sin. Being on a Facebook with dirty people, it's a sin. But it brings excitement to my life. This excitement has a very heavy price. My friend, wake up. You just don't see the price yet, but Hashem is typing the bill for you. And while he's typing, you're adding a lot of things into the cart, into the shopping cart. A heavy price for it. And I would like to finish with what I always finish with, unfortunately. None of us can say that we gain enough mitzvot per day. None of us. I know people that their day is really full, that they learn all day nonstop, they have nothing in their life. So you know, their days, Baruch Hashem, they accumulate a lot of mitzvot. They learn Torah, they teach Torah in yeshiva, they have student classes. Their life is full of mitzvot. Ordinary people don't have that many mitzvot. So what's the solution? To die poor? I'm talking in mitzvot, spiritually. Not talking about money now. I'm talking mitzvot. One person will die with 1 million mitzvot in his account. One will have 10 million. One will have 500 million. One will have 500 billion. The one that has million mitzvot in 70 years and the one that has 50 billion in 70 years, you can give them the same end, the same reward? No. How do you get to such numbers? You buy mitzvot. You invest in a stock market. There's a spiritual stock market. Stock A brings you 200 mitzvot a year. What is it? You buy donuts in Hanukkah for Hanukkah party in a shul. 200 mitzvot. Maybe 200 Jews say bracha, you're lucky, 200 mitzvot. But it can also bring you some sins. It's because of that, they make a mixed party and the guys and the girls, they have all jelly, all like this, and she goes like this, and they make sins later. Your donuts created disaster. He ended up losing. So it's not such a good investment. Building a shul. Most shul are kosher or not. Most shul in the world, it's either reform, conservative, places of Avodah Zarah worship some idol, and the Orthodox kosher one, some of them are not so kosher at all. Either it was built with stolen money, it was built with all kinds of forgery and cheating and lying and laundering money, or if it's not the case, it was built with kosher money. Most of the places people speak nonstop. Politics, sport, Lashon Hara, fighting, arguments, politics, disrespecting the rabbi. So what mitzvah you gain? You paid $1 million, $2 million, they build a place and all day, Hashem Yirachem, what's happening there? So it's also not the best investment, unless if you know for sure it's going to be a strictly kosher place. Then very good. They learn Torah, they daven good, no talking. Baruch Hashem, so that's a good investment. No matter how you look at that, Torah, very big. Everyone will learn thanks to your money, it's your mitzvah. So if you give to a kosher yeshiva or people really learn, you get a lot of mitzvot. But what is by far a million times greater than everything you can think of? What is it? To save souls, to do kiruv. That's why I call my organization Kiruv Organization. Brings Jews back. And many Jews are still ignorant. And time is running out. Why? Because we won't have that many years more to save souls. Maybe we have a few years left. That's it. Why? The media is destroying the reputation of the religion. It's not fully destroyed yet, but it's right almost there already. Soon you won't be able to talk to any secular person about religion. Why? The media with their lies and religious people with their horrible behaving together, joined together to destroy the name of Hashem and the name of His Torah. So we won't be able anymore to come to an ordinary secular Jew, American, Bukharian, Persian, Israeli, doesn't matter. As soon as you come near them, they'll be allergic to you. No, I don't want to see you. I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to hear you. Oh, we hear on the news this, we hear this. My boss is religious. He did this to me, that. My father got killed, that. This person stole, forgery, lies. We won't have any more an opportunity anymore. Now it's still possible. In 3, 4, 5, 7, 10 years, only Hashem knows when the window will be closed. Then we will put our energy and we'll make maybe one Baal Tshuva a month. Right now, Baruch Hashem, there's still hundreds every week. I get a lot of emails. It's still affecting, it goes to territories that people never heard Torah before. They grab a CD, they listen, they go nuts. Wow, where was I until now? So all these people who helps and support, and unfortunately it's not enough. It's not enough. We don't even fulfill 30% of the demands. Many of the orders I have to ignore. can send. If it's far, it's expensive shipping to Europe, this, we skip it. Chaval. If we send 500 CDs to that place, $500 the CDs plus another $80 the shipping, whatever. So for $580, we would get to 500 Jewish families that never heard a word of Torah. Or even if they heard a little bit, they're not keeping Shabbat, and they're not putting tefillin, and they're not having mezuzot, some of them. So it's going to be thousands of mitzvot right away. People change when they listen to the truth. Up to now, they never knew. But this lecture proving, it's not only Musar, it's proving that the Torah is divine. And if you don't believe, just request from me. I'll send you a lot of emails of these people. Every hour, I get few like this. You changed my life completely. Where I was a month ago, you changed my life. Sometimes every 3 minutes, you changed my life completely. The CD saved my life. My entire family now Shomer Shabbat. Now I this. I'm converting to Judaism now. Why? I found out the truth. I didn't know I'm a Jew. Thanks to your CD, I started to inquire. I went, I checked, I found out my grandmother was a Jew. So now it's Shomer Shabbat, this, that. And you have a share in every one of these? And you want to let it go? Where would you gain such an easy investment, such a cheap investment with such a big reward? Where? Find me another source like this in the whole world, and I take my head off for you. The one I have in my car. You got it or no? Find me a better investment. I'm opening for a challenge. Find me any investment in the world that will give you a bigger reward than this. Spreading dollars like this, and people grab it in this, in the grocery. One guy from Miami called me. I had 3-4 CDs left. I was giving a lecture, Motzei Lag BaOmer. It was Saturday night, actually, it was Lag BaOmer, not Motzei Lag BaOmer. So I gave out CDs to all the people, and after everyone left, I have maybe 3 or 4, I left them on a big garbage. There's a big garbage, you know, in restaurants, big garbage can. I left it on the garbage. I said, I don't know, maybe a Jew will come, will pick it up. I got it. Two weeks later, I got a phone call from a Jew from Miami. Where can I get more of these CDs? I said, where did you get it? I picked it up from the garbage can in a restaurant. It's already Shomer Shabbat in 2 weeks. You understand what's going on here? You heard the lecture of Shabbat. How many Jews know Mechalel Shabbat is like a goy? How many? You don't hear it. Nobody dare to say it. How many Jews know they have no share to the world to come if they drive on Shabbat? You have to understand. You can't have 100% success for one reason. Most people are crooks, and they lie to themselves. Who is the biggest victim of a crook? Himself. Because the way he lied to everyone, he always lied to himself as well. So when he hears the truth, he gets angry. He develops all kinds of symptoms against the speaker, against the rabbis, against the Torah, but who cares about him? Let him bark until tomorrow. What do we care? We care for those who are honest. The 10, 20, 30, 50% in different environments, different societies, that are really searching for the truth. They are the ones who right away will change. The ones who wants to live in a lie, believe me, if Hashem talks to them a week later, they make a golden calf. Won't help. Not me and not a million like me. But those who are searching the truth and they're ignorant because nobody approached them, isn't it a shame? Those who are searching, there are many people search for the truth. They search in the internet. They go to all kinds of cults. They're wasting a lot of time. And our job is to try to save them. Bezrat Hashem, I'm done. If there's any questions before we finished, I want to say thank you to Yaniv, to Chazak, for another beautiful event that we had here tonight. Bezrat Hashem, and tomorrow, every Monday, I'm giving a lecture right here in Queens Boulevard in the apartment of Dina Moshe. I've been speaking there for many years. It's 2 lectures in one night. At 8:30 until 10, from 9 until 10:30 it's in English, and from 10:30 it's in Hebrew until midnight. Both lectures, a different topic. The second lecture in Hebrew, it's the Path to the Jazz series. We're almost finishing it a few more weeks. The English series was finished, and it's 21 lectures, 31 hours altogether, and I'm gonna make a CD on it. It fits in a CD. We play with the quality, There will be one CD coming in a week or two, Path to the Just, all the series we did by the shul, by Rabbi Bloom. It will be all in one CD. I'm sure it's going to be a hit because I get a lot of emails on the series from the website. So that will come up. We came up with a new collection, number 4, 18 lectures, new lectures on the CD number 4. I don't have any left. Bezrat Hashem, tomorrow I'll get some new ones. Everything I had is gone already. So we have a new selection. Bezrat Hashem, I'll make a few more selections. The more selections we give to people, more lectures, can give them hundreds of hours of Torah for a few dollars, it's more impact on them for long run. Not only for a week or two. It can stay for 3-4 months. They're connected to Torah in the cars, in the house, in the earphone. The more days they are in Torah, it's going to be harder to pull them out of it because it goes into their system already. Be'ezrat Hashem. Baruch Adonai le'olam. Amen ve'amen.